My name is Robert L. Carlson. I live in Jamestown, North Dakota. In the Army, I was in Vietnam for 1 year, September 1970 through September, or through August and part of September 1971. I was a sergeant, a three-stripe sergeant, for most of that time in Quang Tri. I was in two different locations in Vietnam. I started in the Central Highlands with the 4th Infantry Division. They stood down in November of 70, and so I had only put in 2 months at that time, so I was relocated up to the 1st Brigade of the 5th Mechanized Infantry Division in Quang Tri, Vietnam, which was just 13 miles from the DMZ. And there, to my utter delight, I found two good buddies of mine that I'd be working with there that I'd gone through advanced training with. So that's got me to Vietnam and so forth.
Okay, I'm going to ask you to just put your thing over there
so all right.
You don't tap it. What were your responsibilities? Were you a sergeant when you got to Vietnam?
No, I was a Spec 5. And I was made a sergeant because I was put into a position of responsibility that was that called for a sergeant grade. And then when I left Vietnam and went to Germany, I was back to a Spec 5 again.
So what was this responsibility that you had?
Well, I was trained as an image interpreter for almost a year at Fort Halliburton, Maryland, and to be in the Army Intelligence Service, which those of us, and I don't mean to sound cynical, but a lot of people were a little sarcastic about themselves in the Army, I guess, and we'd often say military intelligence is an oxymoron. But at any rate, I was in military intelligence and trained as an image interpreter, looking at photographs and, you know, deciding what they meant about the enemy. And when I got to Vietnam, they were overloaded with image interpreters, but they were short on counterintelligence people. And I had a history degree, and I had some knowledge of the local culture and so forth. And so they made me a counterintelligence agent, and then I had to be a sergeant that called for. So that's what I did while I was in Quang Tri. When I was in, for the first 2 months, we just kind of twiddled our thumbs in on K in the Central Highlands, so there wasn't much going on. That's near Pleiku, and that had been pretty well pacified, and so they stood down, and then I got reassigned, like I said, to Quang Tri, where they had image interpreters with nothing to do, and counterintelligence, they had nobody to fill the position. So,
what does counterintelligence do? What are your activities?
Yeah, well, it was really quite interesting. We had three agents for a while, and then later two, and we would meet these local people who would give us information about what they believed would be an upcoming event. And then these people had been vetted and determined to be, you know, good people that were friendly to the South Vietnamese regime and so forth. And they'd give us information such as, tomorrow night or 3 days from now, so-and-so, Nguyen Van so-and-so, will be going to his uncle's house to collect rice for his Viet Cong unit. And so then we would alert the regional forces, or maybe sometimes the popular forces, or if it was a big enough event, the South Vietnamese Army, to that, and they would take some action. And then we'd keep a record of how many, what this agent's, was he just giving us information that he made up to get paid in piasters. So we kept a record, and I remember we had an agent, R020 was usually very accurate, one that was a 00, another number, we let go, and we had another one that was right about 20% of the time, which wasn't bad. So anyway, that's what we do, and we'd meet at a safe house. And those were usually places where the Vietnamese could mingle with Americans without suspicion. It was open to like a hospital, or There were sites where Vietnamese would apply to get a job working on the base, doing something or other, physical labor usually. And so there'd be a line of people there, and they'd go in and get interviewed. And so that was another place we could meet.
Was this in town?
This was sometimes in town, in Quang Tri, sometimes on the base, if it was like in the hospital. And we always had I always had an interpreter with me as well. And because I didn't speak Vietnamese any more than a little pidgin English of it, so we had an interpreter. And we'd compile, in addition to that, we'd compile reports. While I was there, I'm backing up a little bit, the U.S. got really concerned that their intelligence wasn't very good. And somebody had totaled up the number of North Vietnamese and Viet Cong that had supposedly been killed by the U.S., the ARVN, the regional forces, and the popular forces, and it totaled up to what was slightly more than the entire male population of North Vietnam. And so that hit the press, and the generals were pretty quick to say, we've got to clean this up. And so we had to keep some, we had to find some authentication if they claimed that they had had a battle the night before. Not the ARVN, we didn't get with them, but the regional forces and the popular forces, they had to be interviewed to prove, we had to verify it. So that was another thing we did. And then we would fly these, we'd draw up documents. There's always a lot of paperwork in the Army, and we'd draw up documents and take these reports down to Hue, which was kind of the regional intelligence center, and then sometimes clear to Saigon. And I would always go with a lieutenant and have the U.S. on my collar, and I would be the guy with the briefcase handcuffed to my wrist, which sounds real cloak and dagger, but it actually, it wasn't. Those are the major things that we did. And then one of the big campaigns, the biggest campaign while I was in Anh Ke, was the Laos incursion of February and March 1971. And that was President Nixon's initiative. He wanted to get out of Vietnam, and the South Vietnamese Army had been doing a lot of training and a lot of improvement over the years, and they'd had some success in Cambodia, and they wanted to go into Laos and cut the Ho Chi Minh Trail, which was bringing supplies and armaments from the north to supply the army in the south, as well as the Viet Cong that were active in the south. And so it was deemed smart to go into Laos and try to interdict that trail and kill a bunch of the communist Laotians, and then destroy the tunnels and the staging areas and everything in Laos. So this was going to be a big test of the South Vietnamese Army, and we did, and from Quang Tri, we did the logistical support and the backup for them, and a lot of the intelligence, especially visual imagery intelligence of how the battle had gone and what equipment had been abandoned and run away from and so forth. That incursion was supposed to, like I said, cut the trail to the north and supplies and help the South Vietnamese army stay in power a long time, but it was a test of their ability to do that. The U.S. was involved from the air and from some helicopters, and we did some pretty close-in support, actually. But it was supposed to be just kind of a hands-off, let the South do this, except for airstrikes, which the Air Force did. It was heralded as a rousing success. It was not, and we knew it from our reports. It was a complete disaster. We lost an awful lot of helicopters. We lost tanks that were abandoned. We lost lots of artillery shells, cases that had been flown in on the big helicopters and dropped for the ARVNs. They'd run away from it and abandoned it. And a few weeks after that operation ended, the North Vietnamese, we had visual evidence, they were doing truck convoys on the trail. So it was heralded as a success, and we began pulling out of Vietnam. And in fact, our unit at Quang Tri, the 1st of the 5th Mechanized Infantry Division, stood down and left right at the end of my year's service. in our intelligence unit, which was a detachment, the 517th Military Intelligence Detachment, also left. And shortly after we left, Quang Tri was overrun. And then it kind of just rolled on south till we had that horrifying exit from Saigon and people hanging onto helicopter skids and everything else.
What do you think went wrong about the incursion in Laos, or was it doomed to begin with?
Before you answer that, you're kind of rubbing your hands together. Yep. There you go. Thank you.
What
went wrong with it? You know, I just don't think the South Vietnamese were prepared. And what I know about what went wrong with it is what I've read and what analysts have said. I can't say that I had a seat of the pants experience with what went wrong with it, but they said there was just poor preparation, that we rushed into this big initiative and big push militarily without proper planning. And I would certainly say that's true, because the equipment that was abandoned, and especially the artillery shells, we had to go in with bomber strikes, arc light strikes from the B-52s to try to blow up that ammunition and destroy those tanks and trucks and that sort of stuff. And we had some of my buddies flew observation planes to look at that. Excuse me. And every day we'd look at the visual evidence of what had we hit and what hadn't we hit. A lot of times our bombers had missed, despite the saturation bombing, we'd missed the target. So that went on for a long time. And that arc light war, to soften up the enemy beforehand, we dropped hundreds of thousands of tons of bombs on that area in Laos. And I have a picture that I gave to your assistant earlier that shows the pockmarks from in the jungle from those bombs. The North Vietnamese were just prepared for it and a determined enemy, and I think they probably scented that the U.S. was looking to leave, and it gave them incentive to work a little harder at giving us a good reason to leave.
When you were in Vietnam, it sounds like you traveled a little bit. What were your impressions of the country?
My impressions of the people were very high. The entrepreneurship of the Vietnamese impressed me right away, from the farmers working in the rice fields and the women planting the rice and the men plowing with the oxen, and careful use of the land. I thought they were good farmers for having, you know, pretty primitive equipment by our standards, but careful farmers and hard working people, and they would they'd take our cast off garbage and make things from it. You know, roofs for their houses from tin cans and things like that. And they do little odd jobs and sell things on the side all the time. And I always thought if they had the chances that we do in America, they'd really thrive. I mean, they're really entrepreneurial and very hardworking. And of course, after the fall of the South, quite a few did come to the United States. And far as I know, they did pretty well with small businesses. So my opinion of the people was very favorable, and I liked them. They were nice, generous people. They wanted to sell you things, but they were nice people. The land was pretty. The destruction from napalm and from the bombing was tragic for them, I mean, in many ways, and I've been so impressed. I was the president of an international farm organization for a number of years, and we had a Vietnamese delegation that were members, and they talked about how they had cleared the bombs and cleared the wreckage and filled in the bomb craters and were busy farming again like they had before. It's a beautiful country. I mean, it was to this boy from North Dakota, who's all Scandinavian, hot, humid weather did not really agree with me so much, but you got used to it after a while. So I didn't always appreciate the climate, especially the monsoons and the humidity, but it's a pretty country, and they've managed to do pretty well throughout. And now they're great allies of the U.S. again, because we have common concerns about China.
Yeah, Vietnamese and China, strange bedfellows.
Yes, yes it is, yeah.
When you were in Vietnam, were you stationed anyplace? Were you getting shelled where you were at?
Oh, yes. In Quang Tri, we got a lot of rocket attacks. Once a rocket hit our ammo dump and blew that up. I remember that well because, of course, we woke up, it was, I don't know, 1 or 2 in the morning or something like that. And the sky was as bright as the sun shining at noon from the burning phosphorus grenades and so forth. And another time, a sapper got through the concertina wire and got in and I guess blew himself up probably and got the ammo dump blown up again or part of it. I think the heavy artillery shells were underground, so they didn't go off, or that would have been a disaster for the whole camp. But a lot of the grenades and phosphorus grenades and lighter arm ammunition went up.
Would you have had helicopters there as well?
Yes. Oh, yes. Yeah. We flew in helicopters quite a bit, going here and there. There were fire bases. There were 4 fire bases closer to the DMZ. And then there was Dong Ha, which was kind of an air base affiliated air spot that was also closer to the DMZ, and they were under a lot of attack. The fire bases, I happened to be at the hospital one day when one of the fire bases, Alpha 4, I think, they'd built a big personnel shelter for incoming rockets, and there was a rocket attack, and 28 guys were inside that one big sandbag shelter, and an armor-piercing rocket came through the roof, blew up inside, and killed all of them. And I remember the stream of helicopters coming in and those body bags coming off. I'll never forget that. But yes, we were under not so much small arms fire, at least I wasn't, but a lot of rocket attacks, and so many that you kind of didn't pay too much attention to it after a while.
Were you able to sleep at night?
Depending on how close it was, yes.
There were some guys that were very anxious about that and disrupted their sleep the whole time they were there.
Yeah, yeah. Well, we had little shelters. After that happened at Alpha Base 4, the fire base, we were all required to construct different kinds of shelters, so they gave us some, I suppose it was like a 6-foot galvanized culvert that had been cut in half, so you'd get half of that about 6 feet long, and then you cover that with some sandbags, and you were supposed to dive into that. But the rats liked that too, and there was always a little depression, so it was full of water, and so you were kind of reluctant to go plunging into that thing. Of course, we lived with the rats in our hooches and tents too, but that's another story. We were farm kids I was a farm kid, and so we learned how to adapt to those things. The other guys did too.
But this was not like an elaborate base like you'd see in the U.S. I mean, this was tents and huts and that sort of thing?
Yeah, the base had plywood floors, but canvas walls and top. But it was, I mean, compared to what the infantry guys had, it was pretty nice. We didn't have a PX you could go to or any, we didn't have a movie theater or anything like that. We did have the USO would come up once in a while, and the donut dollies, as they call them, young women would come and play games, Monopoly or something like that with you. That was a little different, I guess we enjoyed it.
So what did you do for relaxation or fun while you were there?
During the monsoons, we played Monopoly. We had teams and we kept standings. And to this day, I brag, and if this part gets on TV, I'll probably get some challengers, but I brag that I can beat anybody playing Monopoly because we played endless rounds of Monopoly. And I think I know the strategy, but that was probably the main entertainment. And then we'd have shows that would, bands that would come through once in a while, mostly Filipino bands that would play American popular music. I remember Creedence Clearwater Revival, Rolling on the River was popular at that time. And I still remember the Filipinos were singing that, Rolling on a River. So, but mostly we entertained ourselves. In the monsoon time, you know, reading. Well, we had our stuff to do during the days, but yeah, it, you know, the time kind of dragged by, but.
How many people were on the base?
On that base?
Yeah.
You know, I don't know the answer to that, but it was pretty large. There had to be, the biggest part of it was the mechanized infantry. There were probably 8,000 or something like that, maybe not that many. I should look that up, I could, but I'm just guessing.
That's larger than I was thinking.
Yeah.
So it was quite a large base.
Well, especially when we did the Laos incursion, there were a lot of people there. The roads were busy.
You want to wait 1 second and let that motorcycle go by?
Yeah, I'm probably still twitching my hands. You'll have to handcuff me to the side of the chair.
You know, that might be what we do with you, everyone from now on, including myself. Okay, we'll go ahead, Robert. So you were talking about the weather. And it just seems to me that here you are in canvas tents, whether it's the monsoon season or another season. I mean, there's no air conditioning, so you just have to live with it, huh?
Yeah, well, you know, generally it was pretty cool at night, but it could get really hot and humid in the daytime. But you get accustomed to it.
Hard to believe, but. I guess so.
When we first got to Saigon, got off the plane and were in processed in country, we did our little bit of paperwork and they sent us over to a barracks and we all laid down in bed and the only thing we did was lay down and get up to eat and lay down again for 3 days straight just to get acclimated. I remember that well. And it kind of worked.
Did you ever get to go out in Saigon?
Oh yes, when we brought the intelligence reports down, yeah, we stayed in officers' quarters in Saigon and went over to the old Continental Hotel and watched the gecko lizards up on the cement walls and so forth.
What were your impressions? You mentioned the country, you mentioned the people somewhat. What were your impressions of Saigon itself?
Big city, busy city, crowded traffic, pretty hectic. Traffic. I had a sense that it was pretty safe there, although one night I was walking back alone on a street and ahead of me a Jeep parked on a side of a street burst into flame. And I was standing there looking at it for a while and a Vietnamese said to me, get out of here. So I did. But it was... you could obviously see the French influence there. One night we went to eat at a really good restaurant. That was only once. And I remember that it was quite elegant and by our standards at that time, pretty expensive. But I was with some officers in that case and I don't remember who paid. I guess I did a little bit. But anyway, it was a nice city to answer it. It was crowded, hectic. It was like an Oriental city, but the French influence was evident.
Was this sort of a jolt for a kid from North Dakota?
Well, it was really. I mean, this was a new experience for me, and you know, I always liked learning about new cultures, and you know, like I said, I was a history major, so I wanted to know the history, and so I suppose it was eye-opening. I wouldn't say it was a jolt. I mean, I welcomed new experience, naive though I might have been, but.
When you got in the service, did you enlist or were you drafted?
I got my draft notice and then I enlisted to make it short. I had friends who had gone into intelligence, college friends that graduated before me, and and they had communicated back that that was a pretty good place to be if you were going to be drafted. You'd be better off enlisting and being in a unit like intelligence, and so that's what I did.
Were you in the draft lottery?
No, this was before the lottery. The lottery, I think, kicked in about the time I got out in 72, I think.
69, actually.
Oh, was that when it kicked in?
Yeah.
Well, I just missed it then.
Yeah, December of 69.
Well, I went in September. I just missed it.
You just missed it?
Yep.
Yeah. So you'd completed college, though?
Yes, I did. Yeah. And a lot of my friends, I had a teaching degree. I could have sought a job teaching. A lot of my friends had done the same thing. You could get a deferment if you had a teaching job. And I'd watch them, and and they'd say, oh, I'm sweating it out to see if I get a deferment for the next year. And I thought, you know, I'd just as soon get this over with, and rather than go through that pain. And besides, there were so many people applying for, now there's kind of a dearth of teachers, and then there was a surplus, so, or people with teaching degrees. So it wasn't so easy either. So I went, I enlisted, and when I got out, we had the GI Bill and went to UND and got a master's degree, and then worked at the State Historical Society for a while and then went back to farming.
Where did you get your undergraduate?
Minot State, yeah.
So just up the road from here?
Yeah, yeah. I grew up on a farm just about 15 miles north of Minot.
What town was that?
Well, Glenburn was the address, but all our business was with Minot. That's where I went to high school. That's where we went to church and all that business, yeah.
So you get over to Vietnam, and you're over there for a while. Were you scared when you were over there?
You know, no. And I can't say I ever was. I mean, out on guard duty once in a while, you'd wonder, what is that out in the dark there? It sounds like there's a noise. But, you know, and I don't think that's because I'm particularly brave, because I'm not. But I just think when you're that young, I was 23. Yeah, 23. You just think you don't think about it, but you don't think about death. You don't think about mortality. You don't think you're impervious to bullets, but you don't think it'll happen to you. Or at least, I guess, none of us seem to be particularly worried about that. And some of us, some of the guys in the observation planes, aerial observers, got wounded. One guy got pretty badly. He got a shell or a bullet up his spinal column, and I think was probably wheelchair bound the rest of his life. So there were injuries, but it wasn't a worry at the time. I'm probably more worried about my mortality now than I was then.
You mentioned you had gone to Germany after Vietnam. Did you come back to the States first?
Yeah, I came back. I had about a month R&R. Yeah.
When you came back to the States, did you encounter any problems with people disrespecting you because you were in the service?
I did not. In fact, quite the opposite. I flew from Seattle, and in those days they didn't have the hub and spoke airplane system, so you went from Seattle to some place in Iowa, and then three or four stops in Montana, and then finally Bismarck and so forth. And I encountered nothing but almost deference along the way. You had to wear your uniform to get the military discount. So you wore your uniform. People were very, I don't know that they went out of their way to be appreciative, but they certainly weren't nasty. And in North Dakota, people were very friendly to us veterans. At least that's what I always found. In fact, North Dakota had passed a law or an appropriation to pay us a bonus if we were Vietnam veterans. So that was a nice thing when I went into grad school to have that bonus.
When you were over in Vietnam, you were there, a lot of protesting was going on. What did you think as a serviceman over there about the protests happening back home?
And most of my friends, not all of them, but some of them were real supporters of the war, but we thought it was the wrong war for us to be in, and that we were really in a movement for independence, not necessarily a movement for communism. I can't say, we went down from Fort Halliburton once, from intelligence school on a weekend, some of us, to a big protest in D.C. Judy Collins sang, and there were thousands and thousands of people there in the mall. And I saw these kids, you know, protesting, and I thought, you really are naive and kind of silly, some of them. But I shared their goal that we shouldn't be in Vietnam. But I have to say, Bob, that we, all of us did our job. We really did. And we had, you know, an enemy that was trying to kill us and kill our friends. And we had Vietnamese friends, too. And they, our South Vietnamese friends that worked for us, the interpreter, those sources, they just hated the Viet Cong and the North Vietnamese. I mean, hated them with a white-hot passion. Once in a hospital room, we had a prisoner, and the interrogator was there with him, and I was there too, and my interpreter. Maybe my interpreter was doing the interpretation. Anyway, the interpreter and the prisoner, who was laying in bed with an IV hookup, started shouting at each other, and obviously in total anger. And my interpreter pulled his pistol and aimed it at the guy's head, and I intervened, and I said, I can't remember his name or whatever it was. Put it down. Stop. You can't do this. We're in a hospital. And so to answer your question, we did our job. We wanted the U.S. to win, even though philosophically, I mean, we were there. The country wanted us to do this, so we were going to do it. But privately, we thought it was the wrong war. Some of the guys were very gung-ho.
Like any cross-section of the population, I
yeah,
guess.
Yeah.
But I think you make a strong point for when you're there, you're there to do your job, and you don't shirk your duty, so.
Mm-hmm. And a lot of those intelligence, guys that were in intelligence, really did a good job. Some of them got, the interrogators got really a, they'd had probably a year's language training too, so they could speak pretty well, but some of them really got proficient at Vietnamese, and they would study the order of battle, as we call it. That was another unit that would try to determine who was in command of such and such a company and brigade and all that. And so they would, I'd sometimes be there when they were interrogating, and if a prisoner would say, so-and-so is my company commander, the interrogator would say, you're lying. I know who the commander of that company is. It's so-and-so. You're lying. Who is your real commander? That kind of thing. So, and these guys weren't, you know, gung-ho in the war, but they were doing their damnedest to do their job.
Did you, I guess I these safe houses intrigue me. It seems to me that might be a dangerous thing because you didn't know whether these people that were coming to you had another agenda altogether. If you give you false information, that sort of thing, and you know they might be looking for other people that were giving you information. So,
well, the safe house, it wasn't open to anybody that wanted to come in and talk to us. No, it was just for our so-called agents.
So you would be inviting them in individually?
Oh yeah, every time we parted, we'd arrange to meet again at a certain place and time, you know, a few days down the road. Yeah.
So there's a little bit cloak and dagger involved.
Yeah, yeah, and some guys really got into the romance of that. If you remember the TV program I Spy with Robert Culp and
Bill Cosby,
yeah. Anyway, they had that lingo, well, my man, we're going to do this now, and some guys would talk like that. I thought it was a little silly, but they got a kick out of it.
When you think back, what do you think the lasting effects of the Vietnam War has been on America?
You know, that's really a good question. It was the first war that we really lost. I mean, a big war, and we committed an awful lot of treasure and an awful lot of blood to it. what I would hope we learned from that war, and maybe from other wars too, is that it's easier to obtain a military victory than it is to win really the hearts and minds of the people. And we're good at winning battles. We're poor at sustaining ourselves over a long war. And I guess the even a bigger challenge than that is, you know, Afghanistan and Iraq now. How do we deal? That's probably even more problematic in terms of a cultural clash with America. But we had a determined enemy in Vietnam and resourceful, brutal in many ways, but resourceful. And with guerrilla tactics, they were able to defeat us. And I think we learned, I think the military learned from that war how to conduct a guerrilla war, how to respond to guerrilla warfare better. What we learned as a people and a nation was that we're not invincible, I guess.
Well, I want to thank you for driving here and talking to us. Is there anything else you'd like to share that we haven't touched on?
No, I think we've got it pretty well. Just one kind of humorous story. We left from Cameron Bay at the end of a year, and we were put on a big, long airplane. It was like a stretch 7-something or other Boeing plane, but it was really a long plane. And it looked kind of odd it was so long, and there were, I don't know, 300 and some of us on there. And we, Cameron Bay, you take off from a cliff over the sea, and so the engines are thundering, and we're making our way down the runway, and we start to lift, the front end lifts up, and then we leave the runway, and the plane dropped a ways. And I thought to myself, son of a bee, I've been down here for a year, and now we're going to land in the water, and I'm going to drown. I just thought that. Then the plane went up, and I had a seat that didn't recline all the way to Alaska, and I didn't mind a bit. I was really happy to get going.